it'll probably look like, giving us huge amounts of energy. And if you think that the pyramid is no longer giving us energy, you'll be mistaken, because just because you can't see it doesn't mean it's not there. And therefore we use specific technology to see things and find things, like specific lenses and cameras that can capture things that we can't see with our eyes, like specific waves and frequencies that come out the pyramid like this, telling us that there's still something very, very strange coming out of the pyramid. And it's long, long far away from being dead. Why am I so excited about that? Is because that's exactly what I find in the stone circles in South Africa, creating huge amounts of energy. There is a modern day levitation expert, and his name is Ed Leet-Skolnen, who built Coral Castle in southern Florida.
Oh, yeah.
Single-handedly, he levitated and moved these giant 10-ton, 20-ton blocks of coral, offloaded them off the truck, piled them on heaps, and then he carved them and chiseled them and created this amazing place called Coral Castle. And he left it full of clues encoded for us of how he did it. Spectacular swiveling door that they can't fix, haven't been able to repair properly in a number of years now, decades actually, I believe. The same story has become a bit of a legend of a story. They just can't fix it. And he did it single-handedly on his own. One day, two schoolboys saw him offloading the giant blocks. They came home and they told their parents, "We saw the man offloading the stones." "How did he do it?" said the parents. And they said, "He did it with ice cream cones in his hands." And the parents said, "Yeah, right. Go to bed, you naughty children. You're not getting any ice cream from us." But the children were right. And it's based on that I call it the ice cream cone phenomenon. And I would not have known this unless this guy on my last year's tour told me about the story. One of the, you know, well-kept secrets. And why did I find this exciting? Is because I find ice cream cone shaped tools all over South Africa, always linked to the stone ruins I've discovered. I found dozens of them and photographed probably several dozens of them. What would you be doing with these cone shaped tools? What are they for? They make no sense whatsoever. And they're not just restricted to South Africa, but you also find them in museums here in the United States, where they commemorate the building of the temples of Sumer, and these ice cream cone shaped tools were recovered from the walls of the Sumerian temples with the cuneiform hieroglyphs commemorating the building and the constructing of the temples of Sumer. Why would they put it onto ice cream cone shaped tools? Well, you'll figure out why. This is the tool that Ed Leet-Skolnen used for his miracles, for levitation, for everything. Can you spot the similarity between Ed Leet-Skolnen's levitation device and John Searle's energy generating devices? A reconstructed Stonehenge, John Keeley's musical dinosphere, when you take the covers off, you realize that that's exactly what they were. All energy generating and levitation devices. Free energy is everywhere, people. The whole universe is one giant ball of free energy. Why are we paying through our noses for electricity? Because electricity is just a form of energy that's been developed so that they can charge for it, so we have to pay for it. Otherwise, we'd have free energy. There's free energy everywhere. You all know this. We got to work towards that and take back that which was taken away from us. And especially in the ancient stone ruins of South Africa and Southern Africa, as I mentioned, sound as a source of energy becomes a very important factor. I'm going to take you through a few of these, and then we're going to take a break. First notice, the first thing that struck me, it took me nearly 2 years of looking at them and studying these ruins and trying walking through thousands of them, trying to scratch my head saying, what is going on here? This doesn't make any sense. What is this stuff for? Remember that all these ruins are still classified as dwellings and cattle kraal built by the migrating tribes for their cattle or for themselves. So most of them are referred to as cattle kraal and living places. And I see how silly that is. And what a knee-jerk reaction that is from historians and archaeologists. Like, oh, it's got to be cattle kraal. Well, the walls are this high. I'm not going to stop the lions from jumping in there and getting the cattle. Some of the walls are as high as the ceiling, but, you know. And they have no doors and entrances. Oh, they used to load the cattle in over the walls. And they find very narrow doorways. And they say, well, these narrow doorways are, oh, they actually had dwarf cattle in those days. I'm not kidding you. This is all the stuff they make up and put in our history books. It's spectacular. They'll make up any crap because it has to fit their model.
That's right.
What I found is that probably the most important thing ever until we got to this point was that each and every one of these circles is completely unique. There are no two that are alike. That was a huge, huge psychological breakthrough. Each one is completely and utterly unique. And they have all different shapes and sizes. Some are small, few meters across, some are 150 meters across. And not one stands alone. All of them are part of a much larger grid. Here, for example, you can see that extension there is what I call the spider's web effect, which is really where it goes into the agricultural terraces, and they just go on and on. I wonder if we can close that.
But so you can see it still.
Nothing stands alone. This here, you can't see when you're on the ground. So you can't see that there's a horseshoe shape effect there with a circle in the middle and a stone right in the middle of the circle. And this is clearly not something that happens by accident. Also a very important thing to note is that the stuff around the circles that lies hidden below the soil, there is so much around it because they are all connected. Nothing stands alone. But the stuff in between lies buried beneath the soil. There's another horseshoe shape in the middle of the forestry area. Here you can see how this one is connected to that one. Look at all the stuff hidden below the soil here. Mm-hmm. You can see it. It's just exactly at this, as at the time this picture was taken. Otherwise, other parts of the day, you don't even know that it's there. I've walked up here many times. You walk here, you have no idea that when you're walking there, you're walking on these hidden terraces, these hidden circles. It's only when I saw this photograph, I went, oh my God, look at this. It's amazing. And then they build beautiful flower shapes, because flowers are pretty, right? No, you can only see them from the sky. And they're all connected by these stone channels, two walled channels, connecting to this one, there was a channel here, and then it goes into what was a bigger channel here, which is badly eroded by now. All connected, nothing stands alone, but these flower-shaped patterns become very, very important in understanding what these people were doing. How many of these ruins are there? This is the spectacular discovery that completely blows everything we've ever written in a history book out the window. In 1891, Theodore Benn, from horseback, while he was excavating southern Africa and the first guy to truly excavate Great Zimbabwe, wrote that he believes that there are at least 4,000 of these stone structures. Now I need to put this into perspective. Southern Africa is always written about as a sparsely populated part of the world. Only a few thousand people existed there. Like 2,000 years ago or 1,000 years ago, only a handful of people lived there. So Theodore Benn says there, more than 4,000 of these stone structures from horseback. Roger Summers in 1974 did a calculation where he presents 20,000 stone circles. 20,000. Now we're starting to get into some dangerous territory. The population is very, very thin on the ground to make 20,000 structures. Then I got involved in 2007, and within 6 months, I've estimated there were at least 100,000 of these. And I thought, okay, no one's going to buy this. 100,000 stone structures, forget it. In a sparsely populated part of the world, so I started counting them to try and get some sort of semblance of support. And I broke up the Google photographs and the aerial photographs into 100 square meters, 2,000, 10,000 square meters, and I got averages of circles. And eventually, I averaged at 3.62 circles per hectare per 10,000 square meters, which is not a lot. And then I extrapolated those to three main areas, two in South Africa, one in Zimbabwe. Those aren't the only areas. There are other large clusters of these stone structures, but I only used those three. And then just to show you some of the areas, this is all over South Africa, Zimbabwe, Botswana, and I'm finding more and more and more as we go. Sometimes they look like this. This is an aerial photograph, and you've got to start, your eyes have to start to become sensitized and recognize these things. And once you see one circle, you start seeing, oh, there's many more. This is in the Free State in South Africa. Notice the stuff in between the obvious circles here. All the stuff hidden by soil, lies covered beneath the soil. There's a large one on top of the mountain. And just the other day while I was looking at it, I noticed all the stuff here. That's happening there. There's a huge amount of activity there. Some of them are really complex and very strange shapes. And this is just south of Johannesburg. People, there are thousands of these that cover the hills south of Johannesburg. Thousands. Imagine if you had thousands of these ruins in the hills around Toronto and nobody was paying attention to them. It's just insane. And this is other side of Rustenburg, where I grew up, where the platinum mines are. This is closer to Botswana. Look at the density of this stuff. This runs for about 5 by 5 kilometers, as dense as this. This is just another aerial view close to where I live in Waterval Boven, about 3 hours out of Johannesburg towards Mozambique. And by the time I finished counting all these, it wasn't 4,000 or 20,000 or even 100,000 that I found. There were more than 10 million of these stone ruins. And that changes everything in a split second. You know that you're dealing with a vanished civilization that we know absolutely nothing about. This was a shock to the system. And I knew that I'd stumbled upon something a lot bigger than anyone could possibly imagine. As you can see, all of them are connected. That's what it looks like. Pretty much most of southern Africa and large parts of it. What's so special about these ruins? This is Jan Heine's important work. Most of them, all the ones that he looked at, are aligned with the cardinal alignments, north, south, east, west, which incidentally reads news, right? North, south, east, west, north, east, south, west. And sacred geometry. These guys didn't just build them, they knew exactly what they were doing. When you start seeing sacred geometry and five-factor elements coming to life in these ruins, you know that they knew very specific plans for these. And hexagons appear in them. They were clearly doing something we don't quite yet understand, coming to grips with. And this is just beautiful. When you take this equilateral triangle that comes out beautifully, if you take that flat portion of the ruin and you extrapolate that into the circle that's loosely laid over it, it gives you a perfect hexagon. You connect the opposing corners of the hexagon, you get an equilateral triangle that touches the inside circle perfectly. When you finish it, you get a perfect star tetrahedron. Anyone here that works with energies and sacred geometry will know how much energy this particular symbol and this shape creates. And we realize that that's exactly what they were doing. So what were they for? And what happened to them? 10 million or more stone structures. Remember, we have not found any bones. The biggest mystery here, people, is what happened to the people. Okay? I'm not even going to talk about that, because that becomes a whole other debate. We just found the ruins. More than 10 million structures. They were not dwellings. They were workplaces. What were they for? What happened to them? I'll tell you after the break. Let's break for 15 minutes, okay?